Good day. My name is Alyosha Molnar. I'm a professor from Cornell University, and today I'll be talking about techniques and trade-offs in low-power wireless transceivers. So the motivation for the increasing interest in low-power wireless systems is driven by the need to transfer data to and from small, low-cost wireless nodes, basically the Internet of Things. Examples of applications for this include wireless sensors, both wearable and also for things like automation, medical implants, where you need to transfer data from inside the body, and identification and tracking of various things, such as livestock or inventory inside of a warehouse. So what is low power? What does that mean? So we're interested in scenarios where you're allowed to back off performance significantly in order to save a significant amount of power. And we're typically talking about power levels on the range of 1 to 10 milliwatts when the system is active. And the links in this case can be both symmetric and asymmetric. So both things like RFID, but also more ad hoc things like wireless sensor networks. Now, what can we trade off for our power consumption? We can trade off things like range, how far apart our receive and transmitter are, and the loss associated with that. We can trade off data rate, how many bits per second we're sending. We can also trade off more subtle things such as spectral efficiency, interference tolerance, and emission masks. Low power also has a very important implication in system design, which is that a low power system is typically also low cost or small or both. And the reason for that is simple. If you don't need to be small and low cost, then you can just buy a bigger battery, and then you don't need to be low power. So low power really implies these other things. So now what limits the power consumption in a relevant circuit for a wireless? In the analog side of things, ultimately what burns power is generating transconductance, GM. And the reason we care about GM, first and foremost, is because GM in turn sets noise. We know that if we make our GM higher, then typically our input referred noise gets lower. One interesting thing to note is that voltage gain on chip typically does not require more power, because although more gain would seem to imply more GM, it's actually the product of the GM and the load impedance. And we can scale our transistors to keep this ratio or this product high, even for very small and therefore very low current transistors. And this is surprisingly not hard to do. Now, the one limitation on this is when you go to sufficiently high frequencies where you need to actually resonate your output to use an inductor, then the amount of gain versus GM you need is set by the quality of your inductor. And so ultimately, in the end, your power consumption will be partly defined by the quality of the inductors you have available, both their value, their inductance, and also their Q. This is especially important in the context of oscillators, because LC oscillators, they require a gain of at least 1 to work at all. And so therefore, there's a hard lower limit on how much power you're consuming in an oscillator set by the quality of your inductor. I should also note, of course, that you have to consume power in your digital circuitry. This primarily speaks to frequency dividers after your oscillator and then DSP. Now, what sets your system power? The primary things that set the system power relate to your link budget. And these things are the amount of loss, your path loss, the data rate you're sending at, and finally, the spectral efficiency of your system, how many bits per second per hertz you are using. And these things trade off against each other. So if you want a higher data rate, then you have to have less path loss, which means you have to have a shorter range. These also trade off against circuit parameters. And the two important ones here are the amount of power your transmitter is generating, and of course, based on the efficiency of your PA and whatever overhead you have, your output power then relates to your consumed power in your transmitter. And then in the receiver, the amount of power you burn in your low noise amplifier sets its noise factor, and therefore its sensitivity. And so the power consumption in your receiver is basically set by how weak a signal you can detect, again, plus whatever overhead you have in the system. Now, what's important about this is you can actually trade the transmit versus receive performance by, for example, say we started out in this situation where we had a higher output power and a relatively low receive power, we could reduce the transmit power and increase the receive power to actually get an overall same link but lower overall power, because these two things do trade off. The second important point, of course, is that we have to reduce our overhead power as much as possible. And this tends to have implications such as we can't have a particularly high spectral efficiency because, as we'll see in a moment, low overhead power relates to having simple modulation and therefore relatively low bits per second per hertz. Now, first of all, let's look at the transmitter circuitry. The first important piece is the power amplifier. Now, one surprising result in lower power systems is that making a reasonably efficient PA when you're putting out not too much power is actually not that hard. So you can easily achieve efficiencies in the order of 30 to 50% for a low power PA. And the only real trick is to architect your PA so that you match the power output you want to the effective VDD and your load impedance. And so I'm showing a few of the standard architectures here, sort of a resonated common source, simple inverter, and a stacked PA. And the key point here is that with these sorts of architectures available to you, you can reach anywhere from 100 microwatts up to about 10 milliwatts with reasonable efficiency and not too much effort. The second piece of the puzzle is overhead, and that includes things like oscillators, frequency dividers, and so forth. And the main trick here is to try to get rid of as many of these components as possible, so basically everything that's not the oscillator, and along the way, basically saving all that overhead power. This forces us into a relatively simple modulation scheme, such as on-off keying, frequency shift keying, or possibly binary phase shift keying, but lets us get rid of the mixers, all the complicated modulators, and so forth. And so that in the end, our overhead power is basically just our oscillator. And it turns out it's not that hard to make these oscillators relatively low power on the scale of 100 microwatts to 500 microwatts. Now, on the receiver side, the simplest version of a receiver, which basically everyone who enters the low power field first goes to, is a rectifier preceded by amplification. And this is very good for demodulating on-off or amplitude keyed signals at low power. Basically, the power consumption is just set by your very first amplifier stage, which sets your noise floor. And after that, the gain is relatively cheap. It's voltage gain, and you have a relatively low overhead. The main problem with this approach is because you're also demodulating any interference present, you basically don't tolerate interference well at all. Even if you have an OK LC filter out front, you just can't take that much. A modification on this to try to overcome this issue is the super regenerative receiver, which is the same idea, except we replace a lot of that gain with an oscillator sitting right on the edge of oscillation, which basically acts like a very good bandpass filter for us, which makes our selectivity much better. And it's still quite low power. The main problems with that are, first of all, it's not as good a filter as you might think, because these oscillators can be pulled by interference. And it turns out to be relatively tricky to keep that oscillator right on the edge there. So that takes some sort of subtle tuning. Therefore, many people will go to a more standard architecture, which is either a zero or low IF receiver. Now what we have, again, is our oscillator, which sets our overhead power, and an LNA. Turns out things like passive mixers can consume no DC power, and their capacitance absorbed into the oscillator. So that doesn't cost us much. One important point is actually the order in which you do the passive mixing and the LNA for these low power systems doesn't matter so much, because the passive mixers are sufficiently low noise that we can actually afford to put them first. And so there's a sort of a freedom there to trade those off. And of course, the key benefit here is that everything after that, after the mixer and first amplifier, can be very low power, giving us filtering, demodulation, and more gain for almost no extra power, and making us much more selective and able to deal with much more complex modulation schemes. Now, one important thing to think about when designing this sort of system is whether you want image rejection or not, whether you want to generate I and Q or not. And the reason that's an important trade-off is if you do image rejection, you get a factor of two better noise, but you consume typically about twice as much overhead power. So basically, depending on where you're trying to operate, it either makes sense or doesn't make sense to include image rejection in your system. A few other things to think about. One important thing is that the overall supply voltage you're working at, this affects the efficiency of basically all of your circuits. And this supply is typically forced on you by your application. So if you're running off of a lithium battery, then it's 3 volts. If you're running off of a photovoltaic, it's more like 0.4 volts. And you don't really have that much control there, so you really want to design your circuits for your VDD, not the other way around. Two ways you can help that. One is you, of course, can include some regulations, such as a switch capacitor, buck or boost converter, to get the levels right. Or alternately, through circuit stacking, where you take your highest power-consuming circuits and actually stack them on top of each other so they reuse the same bias current and effectively see lower VDDs for each stage. One more thing to think about is the accuracy of your system. Typically, precision, particularly in the frequency of your local oscillator, costs power, basically because to maintain an accurate signal requires continuous power consumption. It's much cheaper to just calibrate it. Now, if you have a less accurate local oscillator, then you basically have to swallow that error in the form of wider bandwidth. So for example, here I'm just showing, if I have an FSK system, I have to separate my symbols a bit in order to eat any errors here. Now, this sort of cost, which comes in bandwidth and therefore noise, can be reduced by having a higher instantaneous data rate and therefore a higher bandwidth. Now, how do I do that given that the amount of data I'm sending is roughly constant? The primary way we can do this is through duty cycling. So if I'm only on a fraction of the time, say 1% of the time, but I therefore can have a 100 times higher data rate when I'm on, I end up actually, it turns out, with roughly the same power trade-offs for the LNA and PA, but now I save a bunch of power in my overhead because my oscillator is simply off most of the time, for example. Now, it's not free, nothing's free, and so the primary costs of duty cycling come in two forms. One is the cost of synchronization. And what I'm showing here is that typically you have to have your receiver on slightly longer than your transmitter to deal with any mild errors in timing. And you have to have some startup time to wake up your transmitter and receiver, and that typically consumes a bit of additional power. So there's ultimately a trade-off in duty cycling where duty cycling can help you, but too much duty cycling might actually hurt. One final point to just note is that not all situations are symmetric. If I have an asymmetric link where one end of my wireless link is plugged in, for example, then I can actually save power at the other end of the link by basically moving power onto the high power system by increasing the transmit power and increasing the power in the receiver. And although this doesn't save everything, it does make the system typically more efficient at the power-constrained end of things. I can do other things besides just cranking up more transmit power and less receive power. For example, I can use the primary base station is the source of the LO for the terminal. I can benefit from asymmetries in data rate and sort of retweak my power for that. And I can use the synchronization part I can load, so to speak, the synchronization costs of duty cycling onto the high power part of the system that doesn't mind. So in conclusion, I can reduce power in wireless circuits a lot, but typically at the cost of either data rate, range, spectral efficiency, or all three. And the way I get that power savings is by appropriately trading off the power in my receiver's LNA and transmitter's PA, by architecting the whole system for low overhead, by optimizing my system for the available VDD I have, and then accepting a sort of reduction in accuracy, particularly in frequency, and kind of co-designing that with optimal duty cycling. And once I've done all that, I can finish up by optimizing my circuitry itself to make the power low. And that's how you go about designing an efficient low power system. Thank you.